tears and I'll sing you a song, and I'll try not to sing out of key. Oh, I get by with a little help from my friends. Get high with a little help from my friends. Gonna try with a little help from my friends. What do I do when my love is away?
Does it worry you to be alone?
How do I feel at the end of the day?
Are you sad because you're on your own?
No, I get by with a little help from my friends. I get high with a little help from my friends. Gonna try with a little help from my friends. I need somebody to love.
Could it be anybody?
I want somebody to love.
On March 9, 2007, the world lost a gentleman. We lost a gentleman. Hi, everyone. I'm John Kelly. I teach music at Woodbury School in Salem, New Hampshire. Now, I'm the first to admit that I didn't know Brad as well as so many others did. But I can assure you, after listening to their stories, Brad Delp was the kindest, most caring person you would ever want to meet. Brad was always willing to lend a hand, or in so many cases, a song, to programs that he felt very strongly about. During our show, you'll be listening to Brad and Beatle Juice as they performed live here at the Seifert Auditorium at Salem High School. We'll also be hearing from some people who will tell us what kind of person Brad Delp was. We'll hear firsthand about his kindness and what a great person he was. So let's take this opportunity now to remember Brad Delp with a little help from his friends.
Yes, I get by with a little help from my friends, with a little help from my friends.
Remembering Brad Delp with a little help from his friends, featuring memorable performances by Beatle Juice.
Can't buy me love. Cause I don't care too much for money. Money can't buy me love. I'll give you all I've got to give you to say you love me true. I may not have a lot to give, but what I got, I'll give to you. I don't care too much for money. Money can't buy me love. Buy me love. Everybody tell me something. Can't buy me love. Say you don't need no diamond rings, and I'll be satisfied. Tell me that you want the kind of things that money just can't buy. Cause I don't care too much for money. Money can't buy me love. So can't buy me love. No, 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 no. Say you don't need no diamond rings, and I'll be satisfied. Tell me that you want the kind of things that money just can't buy. Cause I don't care too much for money. Money can't buy me love. Can't buy me love. She loves you, yeah, yeah, yeah. She loves the tears she's thinking of. And she told me what to say. She said she loves you, and you know that can't be bad. Yes, she loves you, and you know you should be glad. She said you hurt her so, she almost lost her mind. And now she says she knows you're not the hurting kind. She said she loves you, and you know that can't be bad. Yes, she loves you, and you know you should be glad. With a love like that, you know you should be glad. You know it's up to you, I think it's only fair. Pride can hurt you too, apologize to her. Because she loves you, and you know that can't be bad. Cause she loves you, and you know you should be glad. You know you should be glad. With a love like that, you know you should be glad. With a love like that, you know you should be glad. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah.
When I first met Brad Delp, I was starstruck because I tell all my classes about this. When I was in high school, and I'm from the Midwest, I'm from Ohio, my friends and I would take the Boston, well, it wasn't a CD back then, I guess it was a cassette tape, at least it wasn't an 8-track, it was a cassette tape. We would take the tape and we would put it in my friend Mark's cassette player in his truck, and we would put More Than a Feeling on, and we would try to see if we could sing as high as Brad. No, we couldn't, and we would probably be, I would say, driving in excess of the speed limit while we were doing it, which in Ohio is much safer than it is around here, and I'm not advocating speeding, but that's what we did. And so when I found out that he lived in this area, I couldn't believe it. And then when I got to meet him, like I said, I was a little starstruck, and what I expected and what I got were completely different things. I expected the whole rock star mentality, and I've never met somebody so down to earth and willing to talk to anybody. It just nicest guy you ever want to meet. I know everybody says that about him, but it's true.
Oh yeah, like I
When I first met Brad, it was after a winter concert in December of 1994. His daughter Jenna was part of our chorus, and we were getting ready as Top Shelf Productions to go down to Florida. We had auditioned successfully, and we were going to perform down there. And after the concert, I was just putting things away, and this gentleman came over to me, and I knew exactly who he was. My Harachi go booma, booma, booma. And he came over, he said, "Hi, John, I'm Brad Delp." And, you know, he extended his hand, and we shook hands. I said, "I know who you are." I was very excited. He said, "You know, it's great that you're taking the kids down to Florida, and I didn't know if I could help." And I said, "Sure." And he said, I'd love to do a benefit concert with this new band I'm in, Beatle Juice. If you think there's a market for the Beatles up here." I said, "A market for the Beatles?" And he knew that was, I think, that when we were going down to Florida, we were performing a Beatles review. So, of course, it went beautifully, and we were all excited. So Brad and the boys, they came on St. Patrick's Day, March 17, 1995, and they just did such a great show. It was packed. This auditorium was mobbed. More than 700 people. Don't tell the fire department. It was standing room only. And I remember I was walking around the back outside the auditorium, and there were some people, and the people that were selling tickets said, "We're sorry, we don't have any more tickets. You can't come in." And they begged with me. We traveled, I think, from Fitchburg or Lunenburg in Massachusetts to see Brad Delp and Beetlejuice. And so we took care of them. But Brad was just so great. It was his idea to do the concert, and it was the beginning of a great relationship with Brad Delp in the Salem School District.
He was probably one of Paul McCartney's biggest fans. If you were at the house and Paul was on the TV, it was quiet. Paul's on the TV. And he had to listen to see what Paul had to say. And I don't think he ever met him other than just as a fan, but I'll tell you what, he was one of the biggest McCartney fans going. It was evident in the way he treated the Beatles music as if it were something that he had to honor. And certainly came through in the concerts, because you see the way he just nailed every single part. Close Your Eyes, and there's a couple of those songs where you would swear. Penny Lane, Hard Day's Night, a couple of those just dead on.
It's been a hard day's night, and I've been working like a dog. It's been a hard day's night, I should be sleeping like a log. But when I get on to you, I find the things that you do will make me feel all right. You know I work all day to get your money, things, and it's worth it just to hear you say you're gonna give me everything. So why else should I know? 'Cause when I get you alone, you know I feel okay. When I'm home, everything seems to be right. When I'm home, baby, you hold me tight, tight. And it's been a hard day's night, and I've been working like a dog. It's been a hard day's night, I should be sleeping like a log. But when I get on to you, I find the things that you do will make me feel alright. Should I know? 'Cause when I get you alone, you know I feel okay. When I'm home, everything seems to be right. When I'm home, baby, you hold me tight, tight, yeah. All day's night, and I've been working like a dog. It's been a hard day's night, I should be sleeping like a log. But when I get on to you, I find the things that you do will make me feel alright.
You know I feel all right. You know I feel all right. In Penny Lane there is a barber showing photographs of every hand he's had the pleasure to know, and all the people that come and go stop and say hello. On the corner is a banker with a motor car. The little children laugh at him behind his back, and the banker never wears a mask in the pouring rain. Very strange. Penny Lane is in my ears and in my eyes. Beneath the blue suburban skies, I sit and feel wild back. In Penny Lane there is a fireman with an hourglass, and in his pocket is a portrait of the Queen. He likes to keep his fire engine clean. It's a clean machine.
First time that Brad and I had a conversation, it was open house, and his sixth grade son was in my class, and a lot of parents were sitting in the band room here, and I was making my spiel, talking, and at the end, up walks this guy, and he says, "My son is in your music class, and he plays trombone." I said, "Oh, okay," and I said, "You know, trombone's a tough horn for a kid, not a lot of notes," and he said, "Well, you know, I'm John Michael's father." I said, my name is Brad Delp. I said, "Oh, Mr. Delp, nice to meet you." He said, "Please call me Brad." You know, I'm standing there talking with him, and then it hit me, and I went, "Wait a minute. You're like Brad Delp from Boston, Brad Delp." And he said, "Yes." And I said, "Wow, it's really great to meet you," and blah, blah, blah. And he said, it was so funny. I said, "Your son is a very talented kid. He's very serious, and he really wants to learn all he can about music." And he said, "It's funny because I couldn't even get a sound. I've picked up the trombone and I have no idea even what end to blow into." And I just remember he was so unassuming and he was so laid back that you forgot that this man has played in front of millions of people and he's traveled around the world and he's been on tour and he's sold out stadiums all over the place. I mean, he's just a regular guy, which was really, really cool. Then, of course, Beatle Juice got involved here with Woodbury and helping out with his own kids. Later that year, that was in 96, I think, Brad came and asked if he could tape the jazz band we were playing at the mall on the magical evening of giving. And I said, "Sure, of course you can tape the jazz band." So he videoed the kids, and I thought, well, he's doing this for his son because his son's in the group. And he gave me a copy of the video, and it, you know, he made up his own labels and everything, and he was like, they sounded so great. And this was my second year teaching, and the great would have been about the opposite word. It was not good, but he was just so excited to hang out with all the kids. It was wonderful. So that was pretty much how I began to know him. And then obviously I went and saw Beatle Juice a bunch of times, and just seemed like every time he was just, it was like more and more of a friendship. You know, we exchanged emails and we chat every now and then, mostly Beatles related subjects. Occasionally I would throw questions at him about Boston and if they were going back out on the road or if they were writing stuff. And he was always just so, he was so open about all the stuff that he was doing in his life. I think one of the great attributes of his personality was that he could instantly make you feel comfortable. You didn't realize you were speaking with anyone that was famous. He didn't give off any sort of a vibe about him that was any sort of snobbish or anything like that. He just made you instantly feel comfortable.
Tell me that you've got anything you want, and your bird can sing, but you don't get me. You don't get me. You say you've seen seven wonders, and your bird is green, but you can't see me. You can't see me. When your prized possessions start to weigh you down, look in my direction, I'll be round, I'll be round. When your bird is broken, will it bring you down? You may be awoken, I'll be round, I'll be round. You tell me that you've heard every song there is, and your bird can swing, but you can't see me. You can't see me. We'll be right back.
promises all.
Actually, I have a Beatle band back home I was telling Mech about that we do just for fun, because those are my heroes growing up, musical heroes. So we play music one way or another, most of the time.
Brad tells me he had a chance to play with Ringo Starr. You know, I knew who that was. A lot of people didn't know who that was. But, that was probably a great thrill for you.
That was one of the biggest thrills for me, because that was the only one that I've ever met up to this point, and to get to actually play with him is just amazing.
Love is all you need.
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 is all you need.
Love 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 is all you need. Love is all you need.
All right. That's for you. That's great. Peace and love. That's what it was all about, right?
Beatle Juice was a perfect band because they didn't, you know, get in uniform of the Beatles and stuff like that. They were more down to earth, but they did a great job. They still do a great job of bringing back the music of the Beatles. But so it was a real interest of me to get a chance to interview these folks. So I finally got my opportunity because they were playing again in Salem High School, which they had done oftentimes. And so I went down to the auditorium to see if I could get my interview. Well, my story is more of a the fish that got away rather than, you know, the interview that I had done. But it's also a story of the impression that was left in my mind of not only Brad Delp, but the band Beetlejuice. I went down there, and they were in a sound check, so I had to stay in back of the stage. And I just waited for them, and I had turned around, and all of a sudden this gentleman comes running over to me saying, "Hi, how you doing? It's great to see you." And it turned out to be Brad Delp, and I couldn't believe how open he was to get to meet me and talk to me. And so he says, "Hey, where's the bathroom?" "Oh, okay, all right, it's right down there." "Oh, okay, great, I'll be right back." So I waited around, I turned around again, and John Muzz, who is, I believe, the leader of the band, right? And he also plays the drums, says, what is it that you wanted? And I said, "I wanted to do an interview with you folks. I have a program, and I've been doing this for a number of years." And he says, "Oh, right. Well, we can't do anything tonight. We really can't do anything tonight. We really need to sit down and talk about it, but I promise you we'll set up for an interview for you. But in the meantime, why don't you come on over and I'll introduce you to the band." So I was introduced to each of the band members, and I turned around and there was Brad again, and he says, "So you want to do an interview, huh? Why don't we do something right now?" And so John says, whoa, wait a minute. We got a performance tonight. We can't do this right now, but I promise you we'll be able to set up an interview with you. But I couldn't believe the impression that especially Brad Delp left about how interested he wanted to be a part of my life, let alone, you know, to do this interview, so open and free and just soaked in everything. I mean, I saw his eyes and they were just glowing and his bright smile, and I just couldn't get over the impression that he made as a person. And of course, I had seen Beetlejuice before, so they, you know, they're a great band. But it was just 2 weeks, I believe, or 3 weeks later that he had passed away, and I just couldn't understand, you know, why he would do that, because he really seemed to be a part of everybody's life, and he wanted to soak in more experiences, and so it was quite a shock to me anyway.
Thank you. to the life that we once knew.
We were playing at a town hall in Athol, Massachusetts. And, okay, we're singing This Boy, or That Boy. I forget the name of the Beatles song. And it's this beautiful ballad, three-part harmonies. And you know how the song goes. Everybody knows the song. It's off our first American release. And it goes into the bridge, and Brad's singing his heart out. And this boy won't be happy till he loves you. Well, oh, my. Brad's doing his thing. And that boy won't be happy till he's seen you. And the band pulls out. And the microphone stand collapses in half, and Brad's like falling, chasing the mic down. And he looks up at me, and everyone's slow dancing, and they're not even paying attention. But I'm just looking at Brad like, oh God, another blooper. Is anybody videotaping this? I was hoping that someone like Robert here would be down there catching every bit of it, because I would love to see the bloopers back to back.
I was privileged to be invited to sing at the tribute show with Beatle Juice down in Arlington at the Regent Theater. And that was very flattering to me, you know, to be asked to do that. And that band is just amazing to me. I mean, I'm of that age. The Beatles played in the Ed Sullivan Show in February of 64, and that was when I did my first gig. And so the Beatles were always very special to me, and, you know, as I know they were to him, and, you know, I know every nuance of every song, and they just nailed it. And Brad was responsible for a lot of that, because he was a big fan like that. He knew he could hear every harmony, where it was supposed to be, all the eccentricities of the music. He knew everything about that stuff. He was very good like that. And that's what made Beetlejuice so good. And the band is just, they just capture it. They just nail it every time I see them.
I was alone, I took a ride, I didn't know what I would find. Yeah. Another road where maybe I could see another kind of mind. Yeah. Ooh, then I started to see you. Ooh, did I tell you I need you every single day of my life? You didn't run, you didn't lie. I wanted just to hold you. I let you go, you knew in time we'd meet again, for I had told you. Ooh, you were meant to be near me. Ooh, and I want you to hear me say we'll be together every day. Got to get you into my life. What can I be when I'm with you? I wanna stay. Hey!
If I'm true, I'll never leave. And if I do, I know the way. Hey! Ooh, then I suddenly see you. Did I tell you I need you every single day of my life? Got to get you into my life. I got to get you into my life. I was in love, that's a bride. I didn't know what I would find there. Another road where maybe I could see another kind of man there. Then suddenly I see you. Did I tell you I need you? I got to get you into my life.
Bradley was never cut out to be a rock star, capital letters, bold type, italics, and quotations. He was just a regular guy who happened to have a phenomenal voice. He was salt of the earth, nicest guy in the world, no interest in high-profile lifestyles, no interest in flashy cars and big events and parties, and he was just a regular guy. We went to Disney World on vacations and watched movies at home, and he was absolutely happiest when he was just quiet life at home, his family, his friends.
He was great. He was a great friend. Do anything for you. I have a condition, a situation. He would always, always drive me into the hospitals in Boston, be there with me. Good friend. He always, when he'd travel, he'd be the guy to drive you to the airport, pick you up at the airport. Loved doing that. Loved helping his friends in little ways.
One of the things that always drove Bradley nuts was that while he had had so many opportunities and such success, he recognized and knew personally so many very talented musicians, a lot that he considered to be far more talented than himself, who had never had the opportunities, the breaks, the levels of achievement that Bradley had found, and he didn't think it was fair, didn't seem right. He was always talking about this fellow or that woman or this the singer, this musician who's a remarkable talent, and he always said, I can't believe that this person isn't a big star. They're hugely talented. And the foundation is one way to try and rectify that in Bradley's memory, to give those opportunities to the next generation of musicians who might not have those chances or get those breaks otherwise. I think it's a wonderful way to honor the man that Bradley was.
That was always amazing to me, for him to be as famous as he was. And sometimes it seemed like he didn't know it himself. He didn't get that. I remember Lisa saying that to him one time. She asked him to come up and sing a song. He says, "You really want me to come up and sing a song with you?" And she says, "Do you know who you are? Do you know you're Brad Delp?" And he was just very, very humble like that.
Oh, he's a unique, lovable individual. I think, like all of us, we have our we have our abilities, and and Brad certainly had his many attributes, his voice, and his friendly fellow that he was, the person that wanted you to have a good time. I think that's what makes up Brad Delp. He was just happiest when everyone around him was happy, and he would go out of his way. He's a very generous fellow to go out of his way and make sure everybody's having a good time around him.
There was an article that I have on my desk at the house. You know, somebody wrote it. He was a friend of mine. And, you know, there's thousands of people who could say that, because he was.
Bradley touched the lives of the people he knew in remarkable ways. And a common theme among those people is that I am a better person for having known Bradley. More than that, I think that people, I especially, can know that we are good people because Bradley loved us. It's an excellent gauge. Bradley is a reason to believe in miracles. He was a wonderful, wonderful man.
He loved the Beatles. Not only that, he loved singing the Beatles the way it was done. He thought that was sacrosanct. He didn't feel that any modification to the way it was done was appropriate. He thought Beatles music was perfect.
Once on his way to get back home, once on his way to get back home, sleep pretty darling, need you not come, and I will sing all about. Away to get back home. What's his way to get back home? Sleep pretty darling, do not cry, and I will sing.
Oh, you're gonna
the record. We appreciate it. Thank you. Great time. Thank you.
I've heard it said that life is not a dress rehearsal. We're supposed to make the most out of the time that we have. And there's no doubt that's just what Brad Delp did. And it was so nice of him to take us along for the ride. Thanks for watching.
Next year. You guys are great. Thanks for coming off the top shelf.